All rise and welcome back to the Conduct Detrimental Sports Law Podcast, where we'll enter final judgment on all the top sports law controversies of the day and where opinions are never subject to appellate review. On today's docket, the sports tax man himself, Robert Raiola, bringing the tax heat to Major League Baseball free agency and breaking down the latest Jock tax lawsuit filed against the city of Pittsburgh. Coming up next on Conduct Detrimental. I'm back. Conduct Detrimental with Dan Worley and Daniel Wallach is now just Conduct Detrimental with Daniel Wallach. What happened? Where do I begin? First off, welcome back. My friend and former podcasting partner Dan Worley, who started this with me 3 years ago, has gone to work for a professional sports team, the Nashville Soccer Club. He's their new general counsel. And while being visible works well when you're in a private law practice, and actually that's encouraged by law firms, you know, who want their lawyers to be thought leaders and visible and quotable. It doesn't work that way in the corporate world, which is a little bit more of a button-down experience. And Dan is a big-time lawyer now in the sports industry, but along with that rise comes a need for some bit of discretion. And if you know anything about our show, discretion definitely is not the better part of valor. So we're going to wing it, sling it, dice it, dish it, and swish it, but we will definitely be opinionated. Or rather, Dan, who will always be my friend, I wish him well in his new position, and I expect that we'll be hearing a lot of good things about Worley in the future. He's always welcome back, but I have a feeling that it'll be in the pro sports world for a lot longer than this program will exist, but I'll do my very best to make this program the Gunsmoke of sports podcasts. Okay, so why didn't we do any shows for 2 years? I mean, we were going strong and steady, 2016, 2017, and then what happens? Well, a lot has happened. Dan and I each went into our own respective law practices. We left, you know, big law. Dan left Foley and Lardner and opened up his own firm based out of Nashville. I opened up my own law firm based out of Hallandale Beach, Florida. By the way, I still run the firm and specialize in gaming law, sports wagering, with a little bit of sports-related industry work and litigation. But even going beyond that, I got married, moved. All these like life changes happened to me within a one-year cycle. I mean, when we first started this show, I didn't have a girlfriend, wasn't engaged, certainly wasn't married, was at a job I couldn't stand. Dan was at Foley and Lardner, and we had nothing better to do with our time than do podcasts. And then real life interceded, and it became a little bit more of a challenge to find time, because when I was available, Dan wasn't. When Dan was available, I wasn't. And I couldn't do a show without Dan, because he was the producer of everything. He did everything behind the scenes to make the podcast, the MP3 file, to sort of put it out there on the internet. And I didn't know how to do any of that myself. So after crying about it for the past year, I decided to put out an APB on Twitter looking for a producer. It's not a high-paying job, so don't send your resumes in, but I found this great kid. Name is Robert Schmitzer, and he's a podcaster. He does Chicago Bears-related podcasts, and he's helping me out. And with his help, I was finally able to figure out a few things to at least allow me to begin taping a podcast. And this is the fruit of our labor. So I thank Robert for joining me and helping me in this endeavor. And going forward, we will begin to podcast, or I will begin to podcast on a regular basis. So I would look for weekly shows at a minimum, and I'm going to try to tape a few of them at once. So if I get busy, I usually have one or two in my back pocket. And of course, The great thing about the world of sports law is that it is so unpredictable. You don't know when the next story is going to come around, the next controversy, the next lawsuit being filed. So I will be on standby to deliver emergency podcasts whenever there's a breaking story that affects the sports or gambling industries. That's a continuation of my mission statement. And, you know, as we look ahead, I have no idea what I'm really doing in terms of a format. I'm going to experiment with a few ideas, but basically the setup of the show is it will be a monologue for about 10, 15 minutes leading into a featured guest. So within the monologue, I'll just about a few of the items that are taking place in the world of sports law, focus on some of the lawsuits, Colin Kaepernick or the Antonio Brown saga, whatever is happening during the week in sports law, I will try to hit in a quick scattershot basis, give a few opinions, give you my thoughts on what's taking place within and outside these controversies and what I see ultimately as potentially happening. So I'll try to lend some legal insights into some of the sagas that you're reading about on ESPN or, you know, consuming at other media sites. So I want to try to bring a legal perspective to these stories. So with getting that out of the way, once I finish with a monologue, I would expect every show, and this one is no exception, to have a featured guest. And this is going to be an exciting one for me because Robert Raiola is somebody that I've actually really tried to, you know, emulate on Twitter 5 years ago when I was first playing around with Twitter. I had something less than like 200 followers. Now I'm up to over 20,000. Robert was a certified public accountant, and today he's up to 60,000 followers on Twitter. He has managed to navigate and master Twitter, and it really is a tutorial for any legal services or accounting services professional that wants to try to reach the masses on Twitter. But I think Robert's key to success is, one, he focused on a national industry, sports, and he brings something really unique to the table that no one else really has brought to the world of Twitter and sports, which is, you know, sort of the tax law expertise. So he's somebody that I've become friends with over the years, and a lot of the success and good practices that I've developed on Twitter are largely attributable to Robert and people like Michael McCann and Gabe Feldman showing me the way. So I'm really excited to have Robert on the program today, where we will focus on the latest tax-related issues in the world of sports. And, most particularly, that's going to focus on the latest lawsuit filed against the city of Pittsburgh over their formula for taxing visiting professional athletes who come to Pittsburgh and play in pro games at the various publicly funded arenas. The city of Pittsburgh has enacted an ordinance in which they tax visiting athletes, non-resident athletes, 3% of their earned income attributable to the games that they play in Pittsburgh. And Robert and I will discuss the various issues surrounding that lawsuit, the different methodologies that the city of Pittsburgh uses to tax athletes, because it's somewhat of a complicated formula. The city of Pittsburgh taxes non-resident NFL players under a duty days formula, whereas the National Hockey League and Major League Baseball visiting players are taxed, I believe, under a games played formula. And Robert will try to break that down, and we'll discuss some of the legal issues, some of the constitutional issues that are in play as part of this lawsuit, which was only filed a couple of weeks ago. And from there, we're going to transition into Major League Baseball free agency and how the different tax rates from state to state. Some states don't even have a state tax, Florida, Texas, whereas others, like California, you know, New York, have much higher tax rates. District of Columbia taxes their resident athletes at a rate of 9.5%. So depending on what state you reside in or what state your team plays in, that could go a long way towards determining where some of these top flight players are going to be playing next year. If you're Garrett Cole, a $250 million contract, sure, you want to play for a team that has a winning tradition, but you also don't want to leave, tens of millions of dollars on the table because you're going to play in a state with a high tax rate as opposed to maybe going somewhere that where the tax rate is low or non-existent, at least on the state level. So we'll talk about the lawsuit. We'll talk about Major League Baseball free agency. And of course, I'm not going to let Robert go without delving into how the hell he does it on Twitter and how he broke into the sports industry. I think it would be an instructive guide for all of the students, law students in our audience who want to break into the sports industry. And, you know, everybody has their own tale to tell. Robert got into it one way. I got into it simply by virtue of, writing, not tweeting, but writing articles and blogging. And somehow I mastered this one narrow issue called sports betting back in 2014. I wouldn't say mastered it, but at least focused on it to a point of obsession where it was the only topic that I ever blogged about. So that's the monologue. And we're going to now turn to our featured guest, Robert Raiola.
A group of current and former pro athletes are suing the city of Pittsburgh over jock taxes that it levies on visiting athletes, claiming that the fees are discriminatory and violate both the Pennsylvania Constitution and the United States Constitution. New Jersey Devil forward Kyle Palmieri and several other professional athletes have joined forces with the Major League Baseball Major League Baseball Players Association, the National Hockey League Players Association, and the NFL Players Association to challenge a so-called usage fee associated with publicly funded venues. Now, they don't call it a tax, but they call it like a usage fee and or a license. And this raises a lot of the same issues that we've encountered or that the legal world has encountered in prior situations involving state tax levies against pro athletes. And to help us break down the issues is our good friend Robert Raiola, the director of sports and entertainment at PKF O'Connor Davies, a top 25 accounting firm in the United States. And Robert, welcome to Conduct Detrimental.
Thank you, Dan. Pleasure to be here.
Yeah. Now, we've been down this road before. You and I have been talking about jock taxes going back 5 or 6 years. I mean, for anyone who remembers, there were lawsuits filed by former Indianapolis Colts center Jeff Saturday. There was the, the Hunter Hillmeyer?
Hillmeyer and Saturday.
Yeah. I mean, in fact, I think more people are familiar with those players. At least sports lawyers are familiar with their names from their association with those lawsuits that were filed years ago and presumably have already been resolved and have established settled law. So what's different about this case?
Add to what you said, there was also the state of Tennessee privilege tax, which the players will challenge and were successful. They were taxing players $2,500 a game, no matter whether you made $1 million or you made $100. They were taxing each player the same with a maximum of 3 games. But the Players Association was successful in getting that overturned. This is very interesting because the players feel that the city has adopted a tax scheme that unlawfully disfavors professional athletes who are non-residents. In other words, if you were a resident of Pittsburgh, you're only going to pay 1% tax. If you're a non-resident of Pittsburgh, you can pay 3% tax. And the players feel that the association and the players, plaintiffs, feel that's unfair.
How is the tax collected? Do the players have to file tax returns and hire somebody like you to, pay the city? Or is it something that's withheld
from right out of their paycheck?
By whom? By the team?
Yes.
Okay, so the teams have to allocate monies and pay all these different municipalities. How many cities are taxing athletes like this across the country? Is Pittsburgh an outlier?
No, yeah, Cincinnati, Detroit, St. Louis, Columbus. There's probably about 6 or 7 cities that enforce the tax law.
Okay, why is this one being challenged as opposed to the others?
I think it's because it's not, you labeled it a fee. The lawyers for the plaintiffs feel that it's really a tax under the guise of it being a fee. And being that it's unfair and discriminatory against the players. In other words, if Dan Wallach and Robert Raiola went to the city of Pittsburgh, we wouldn't pay the tax. We only pay 1%. But if an athlete went, he'd pay 3%. So they feel it's discriminatory against the athletes and they're looking to overturn. And although I guess you can't use the citation of the Hillmeyer and Saturday cases, that that bodes well for the players.
Okay, the players won those cases because
they did. Yep.
It would in Jeff Saturday's case, he was being taxed for his performance in Ohio, even though he didn't play in the game. He stayed
back
home.
He was back in Indiana. Yes.
Okay, but the Hunter Hellmeyer one was a companion case, which was really the more important case because the Ohio Supreme Court found that the use of a formula called, I guess, games played as opposed to duty days was unconstitutional. Can you explain the two different methodologies for how city and state governments may tax visiting athletes?
You take a player's salary and you multiply a fraction. The numerator of which is number of games or number of days worked in a particular state, and the denominator, which is the total number of games per year. You multiply that fraction times the total player salary, and then you would take that times the income tax rate. That's how you would do that. Now, it's interesting in Pittsburgh because Pittsburgh uses games played for NHL and MLB, but for NFL, they use the duty days method. So you might see a compromise in leaving the tax in, maybe making it equal to for all people, residents and non-residents, and then use the duty day method throughout. I'm not sure how they're going to answer the complaint.
Which comes out worse for athletes? I mean, I'd imagine that if you use games played, if an NFL player plays one game in Pittsburgh, he's taxed at 1/16th of his salary, but under duty days, it's like 1/365. Is that how it's calculated?
First of all, you would probably get to count the preseason games in the games played method. So it'll be 1/20. And they don't let you count 365. That you have to count the days that in with organized team activities known as OTAs in the off season, and then the total number of days worked in during the rest of the calendar year. So it would probably be, you know, maybe 160, 170, that fraction. And the duty days method works out much better for the players, especially the biggest sport. It's different is in the NFL.
So wait a second. But you pointed to a disparity in the way the city of Pittsburgh taxes the different leagues.
Correct.
That baseball and hockey are taxed using the duty days method?
Games played method.
The games played method, which would be like what? 1/162 or hockey 1/80?
I think they let you count preseason. Most jurisdictions let you count preseason, but your logic is correct.
Okay, so why is the NFL? Why are the NFL players being taxed at a different rate, which would be what, duty days, which would be more forgiving and more beneficial for the players? Why doesn't the city of Pittsburgh just use the same methodology across the board, particularly if the duty days method is going to yield more tax revenue for the city?
I think the duty days method will yield less revenue for the city, especially in football. Because if a player plays one game there, it's 1/20, right? If you count preseason.
Right.
But if you count days worked, so the team would go to Pittsburgh on a Saturday, you would count 2/160 or 170. So there would be a lot lower fraction under the duty days method.
Okay. It's so complicated. That's why we need to have experts like you help break this down. I'm a lawyer, but I do have a bachelor's degree in accounting, but I never sat for my CPA exam. So I've got to turn to you for a better explanation of how all this works. Robert, is this a fair tax?
I believe it's not fair. I believe it's discriminatory against the professional athletes. Like I said, if an accountant, a lawyer, a professor goes to the city of Pittsburgh, he's not paying the tax. But a professional athlete is because he's high profile, high salary, and he doesn't have the ability to vote to nix this thing. So it's going to be an interesting result, but hopefully the players prevail.
How about Bruce Springsteen? Is he taxed when he puts on a concert at PPGE Paints Arena? Would he fall under that tax?
I think that he would be. I don't think it's just for athletes. I know he's taxed as it goes to all the different states for sure. Again, high profile, high salary, easy to track. With the advent of the internet many years ago, it's very simple to know that they were there. If Dan Wallet comes to New York to speak, not as easy to track him.
Yeah, but if Robert Raiola gave a paid lecture in the city of Pittsburgh to a group of, you know, I guess CPAs, and you were paid, $1,000. Well, let's say no, that you deserve more money than that. If you were paid $10,000 for the speech, and you flew to Pittsburgh, gave the speech. Clearly, all of the money is earned in Pittsburgh. Would you have to pay a non-resident's usage fee tax, or does this only apply to, like, arenas?
The non-resident usage fee tax applies only to arenas and only to professional athletes. Now, I would think Springsteen would be included as an entertainer, but I'm not 100% positive.
How about Southside Johnny? No, okay. What are the arguments? What are the legal arguments or the main arguments that the players' associations and the players are raising to overturn this?
They contend the city has adopted a tax scheme, otherwise known as a fee, that unlawfully disfavors professional athletes who don't reside there. In other words, if you're a resident and you go play there, you're only paying 1%. If you're a non-resident and you go play there, you're paying 3%. They believe it's unfair and discriminatory to non-resident professional athletes.
Okay, but aren't professional athletes who play for the local teams also taxed as well?
They are, but again, it's one tax rate if you're a resident, another tax rate if you're non-resident. The tax rate for non-residents are three times as high as they are for residents.
Okay, so this is a little bit of a different type of argument than the Saturday and the Hellmeyer cases in right. that it's not a duty days versus games played sort of issue. It's more the disparity in how non-resident athletes are taxed relative to resident athletes. Would that be correct to
right.
distinguish?
That's the biggest thing. It does mention towards the end of the complaint, it does mention about the duty days formula, and I wouldn't be surprised if they convince the city of Pittsburgh to jump on board. Cleveland, that case was litigated, and Cleveland now uses the duty day method across the board.
Okay, how does the city even use this money? I mean, it can't amount to all that much in the final analysis, right? It's a couple of million dollars, maybe at most, that's generated by the tax. Does the city use it in a way to offset costs associated with these venues, or does it go into a general fund?
That's one of the things that they use it for. I'm sure other cities are different, but that's the argument that the city makes.
Okay. So how will this case affect athletes playing in other cities? Is this unique to Pittsburgh? Do any other states have, you mentioned that seven cities tax visiting professional athletes, but this scheme in Pennsylvania, in Pittsburgh, is pursuant to a statutory framework that gives municipalities the ability to impose these non-resident usage fees associated with professional sports, publicly funded professional sports venues. To your knowledge, does any other state have a law like that?
Not to my knowledge, but it's also very unusual that they have two sets of laws, one for the residents and one for the non-resident. I think that's the gist of the argument from the plaintiffs about being taxed a different way. Mm-hmm. I think it may influence others, or may the lawyers for the Saturday's case and the lawyers that argued the Tennessee privilege tax were the same lawyer, Steve Kidder out of Boston. And he's also the lawyer, plaintiff's lawyer on this case. So they are going after them. And the biggest thing they're arguing was discriminatory against their clients, the athletes, and all the players' associations.
How far back are the players and the players' associations trying to reach back? Are they trying to recover taxes associated with just one tax year? Or is there a statute of limitations that limits the ability of these plaintiffs to go back beyond a certain date?
What they're saying to do is to file a protective refund claim going back as far as 16. So they're encouraging people, and we've been in the process of filing protective refund claims for 2016, 17, and 18. And that way, if they win the lawsuit, the player would get that tax back. Now, the numbers are not big unless you played for a Pittsburgh team, but if you played for Pittsburgh-based teams, the numbers could be $10,000, $15,000 range if you're playing for a Pittsburgh team.
So let's say you're Ben Roethlisberger and you happen to live in the suburbs outside the city of Pittsburgh. What would that mean for someone like him? The differential, would it be it would be hundreds of thousands, or it'd be
but you also don't know what jurisdiction he lives in, and maybe that jurisdiction has a local tax as well.
Okay. If the players win, how much exposure does the city of Pittsburgh have? If you're talking about hundreds, if not maybe a couple of thousand of athletes going back 4 years, I would imagine the look back period would be a 4-year statute of limitations. If the players win here, what are we talking about in terms of what the monetary recovery could potentially be?
I'm not familiar with that. I could try to run that number down, but I'm not familiar with how much they would get. And it's 3 years back, 16, 17, and 18. So So it's not 4 years, it's 3 years back.
Okay, and you mentioned that's still going to be a lot of money, you know, when the dust settles. It would have to be at least a seven-figure sum. I want to get back to duty days versus games played formula. I think the flaw or the issue that I have with those formulas is that regardless of where you come out on what the numerator and denominator are, they both make the false assumption that the player's salary is completely attributable to the game he plays in the visiting venue, right? If Artemi Panarin on the New York Rangers is scheduled to play against the Pittsburgh Penguins, he's got a guaranteed contract, 7 years, I don't know, $81 million. If the team rests him for that game, or if he decides, you know, he's got, you know, got to has to take a leave or something, he gets paid whether he plays against the Penguins at the PPG Arena or not. And so much of his salary, maybe hockey is a bad example, but in football, so much of an NFL player's salary is indirectly bumped up by virtue of these lucrative national television contracts and all the streaming rights. How could it be said that the city of Pittsburgh creates the value associated with the 1/20 or the 1/365? Because that falsely assumes that the income was created by virtue of that publicly funded venue in Pittsburgh being made available. If there wasn't a game against the Penguins, there would be a game against someone else in some other city. So could that be a potential line of attack against a tax like that, because it does give the city maybe a little bit too much credit for creating the value?
That's the duty days method is the more common method, prevalent method of taxing athletes as they go from state to state. There's probably about 25, 26 states that have a jock tax, plus the 7 or 8 cities that have one as well. And I think they're going to look to this situation being unconstitutional. They're not allowed to charge a tax, so the way they get around that, they call it a fee. When the plaintiff's lawyers have argued that this is really a tax, it's not a fee. So that's going to be, you know, what they go after there.
Is it a tax or is it a fee? They call it a usage fee, and alternatively, they call it a license fee, but it's based upon income earned. So as a practical matter, it sounds like a tax, but they label it as something not a tax.
Right, because they're not allowed to charge a tax. That's why, and that's what the lawyers are saying. Look, you call it a fee. That's not really a fee. It's really a tax.
A bird by any other name. I mean, is it a tax?
I think the plaintiff's lawyers argued that it is, and I believe that they're correct.
I think it would be more appropriately categorized as a license fee if it was the same amount for every player. You have to pay.
Right. That's what Tennessee uses.
Yes, so Tennessee has an even-handed uniform application of a privilege or a license fee. So a license fee that's tied to income levels sounds more like a tax than it is a license fee akin to what Tennessee does. So that's interesting. How long do you think this goes all the way to the Pennsylvania Supreme Court? I know that's more of a legal issue, but we're at the very beginning of the case. Is this something that will play out over a couple of years, or will it be expedited?
I don't know enough about the Pennsylvania judicial system and how this will play out, but I'm sure the city's going to answer the complaint, and then they'll see what's going to happen. You know, again, especially for the revenue that was already taken from the players for 16, 17, 18, if they got to give that back, that may have been money that they already spent. So maybe they compromise a little bit. I'm not sure what they're going to do. I don't know how long it will take to flush this thing out.
Yeah. Are cities being greedy here?
Well, again, it's easy to do, easy to tax. Athletes are high profile, high salary, and easy to tax. And they can't vote. Mostly if you're a non-resident, you're not allowed to vote. So it's big numbers, and it's an easy way for cash-starved cities, or even if you're not starved, an easy way for cities to fill their coffers with this tax on non-residents.
Yeah, but I mean, some lawyer in the city's, you know, I guess, general counsel office could just easily find the Saturday case and the Ohio Supreme Court case. It seems pretty easy to follow that if you're a city attorney, the advice you would give to the city is, okay, you can tax athletes, you can tax visiting athletes under this statutory scheme, but in order to protect the city from a bunch of these refund claims, maybe we should tax them in a fairer method rather than go for the jugular and try to tax at the highest rate, have these disparities between residents and non-residents, and then use a formula that has been declared unconstitutional by the Ohio Supreme Court. So why do cities persist in just going down this road of illegality when there's already precedent established in other jurisdictions?
I think that you raised the point before about paying for the cost of managing the stadiums, but you know, it seems to me remotely unfair that there's differential in rate, 3% to non-residents, 1% to residents. I think that's unfair, and they were looking for fairer treatment on that. And, you know, again, they're not allowed to charge a tax on the Pennsylvania jurisdiction, but they call it a fee, but looks like might be and probably is a tax.
Yeah, but the statute enacted by the Pennsylvania legislature gives municipalities the option of either choosing a flat dollar amount or a percentage of the individual's income attributable to the usage, which may not exceed 3%. Given how little money is involved on a player-by-player basis, I mean, Kyle Palmieri in 2016, he played a few games a year in Pittsburgh. His portion of the tax that was allocated to him was under $2,000. We're not talking a lot of money. Wouldn't the cities be better off, or at least a city like Pittsburgh, be in a safer place if they just allocated a flat dollar amount on a per-player basis? Because right now, what they're going to be spending in legal fees to defend this lawsuit and then the risk associated with having to pay out damages, I mean, kind of makes this a no-win proposition for the city of Pittsburgh, even if they prevail.
I think they're going to try to push them to not tax the residents and non-residents in a different manner. Okay. And it's easy to do for the cities to go ahead and do this. You know, they may not be broke or whatever like that, but it's easy revenue for them to gain.
Okay. Well, so ultimately, do we have Michael Jordan to thank for all this?
Michael Jordan's revenge. Yes, indeed.
Can you tell us the story? I love hearing the story about how the jock tax basically was birthed. It's not a new phenomenon, but it doesn't go back that long in time either. Cities weren't doing this in 1970 or 1980, so why now?
Again, easy to tax, easy to get the revenue, you know, easy to track. Basically, what happened with Michael Jordan, the Lakers and the Bulls were playing in the NBA championship in the early 90s, and the Illinois legislature got wind of the fact that their athletes were paying tax to California. So in a bill informally titled Michael Jordan's Revenge, they began to tax states that were taxing their players, like California and Illinois and New York as well. So that's why the bill was informally titled Michael Jordan's Revenge.
Okay, but this has been good for Robert Raiola. I mean, this is what you do as part of your practice. Would it be simpler if the states or if the municipalities didn't assess separate taxes against visiting athletes and have the income, you know, because at the end of the day, they're giving credits to local, the home states are giving credits for taxes paid in the other state. When the dust settles, it's all pretty even, Steven. So why even do this at all?
But the thing is, Danny, the rates that the states charge are, you know, as low as 3% and as high in California as 13.3%. So if you live in Illinois and you pay tax to California, you're not going to get a credit of 13%. You're going to get a credit of 3%, so you're out of pocket a lot of money.
Yeah, so this is a perfect segue into Major League Baseball free agency. I mean, if you're sitting on the top of the mountain right now, like Garrett Cole or Steven Strasburg, there are going to be a lot of teams in cities all across the United States that want to recruit you to play for their teams. And the tax rate differentials from one state, from one city to the next may play a significant role in some of the decision-making that these players have to make. Can you tell us how impactful the state taxes are on a player's free agency decision?
Sure, Dan. I think a lot of times when an athlete goes to make a decision, and use the word decision, you know, for what LeBron had his decision. LeBron, we thought he went from Cleveland to Miami for a couple of reasons. One was to win championships, check the box, he did that. And two, to avoid the tax. But while he was still in Miami, he put on Instagram, I'm going to do my civic duty and serve jury duty. A non-resident of Cleveland, of Ohio, I think it was in Akron, a non-resident of Akron wouldn't serve jury duty. Only a resident would be. So maybe he was a resident all along. But there's two basic methods, which we talked about, duty days and games played method. And there is some planning, which we'll get into to mitigate some of the taxes. But it's big revenue. You know, California used to give out every year, they used to give me the amount of revenue that they raised from professional athletes. It was a high number. As high as I think $240 million, and that was back in 14 or 15. So it does add up.
Well, players have to pay, it sounds like, three level of taxes. We all have to pay federal income taxes, but it varies from state to state as to whether there's even a tax on the state level. And then if there is a tax, the rates are going to be different. And then on top of that, sounds like you've got to also deal with jock taxes. So
how does that
shake out for an athlete like like Garrett Cole, who reports speculate will generate or garner somewhere in the neighborhood of, I don't know, it could be a $300 million or $200+ million contract. How much money are we talking about in the difference between, let's say, playing in Anaheim versus playing in Miami? Not that the Miami Marlins have enough money to scratch together to make an offer. But how much are we talking about in terms of significance of the amount in question when you take state taxes into account?
Sure. Let's take Zach Wheeler, who's rumored to have gotten several offers in the $100 million range. If he signed with the aforementioned Marlins and he got $100 million, he'd only pay the jock tax on some of the road games against the Mets, against the Braves, against the Astros, against the Angels. Not against the Astros, sorry. The Angels, he'd pay jock tax. But he wouldn't pay any state tax to Florida, so it would be tax free. Whereas if he signed with the Dodgers, you know, 13.3%, and he was a California resident, 13.3% of $100 million is $13 million, a lot of money. So I think, Danny, when players decide where they're going to go as a free agency, they look at several things. How's the climate? Do I know the coach? Is the team ready to win a World Series? Or the last category. Am I going there for the biggest offer of money? And somewhere on the checklist will also be how to stack taxes pay. Because very often, the best gross offer will not be the best net offer. So in other words, when the Ndamukong Suh signed with the Dolphins years ago, he signed for $60 million guaranteed. After taxes, that was about $36 million after taxes. If he would have signed with the Lions and wanted to net the same 36, he would have had to been paid $65 million. And if he was going to sign with the Oakland Raiders, he would have to pay $70.1 million to net him the same. So it's a big difference, and he'd further into that salary cap. So the NBA Players Association has argued that they should do the salary cap on an after-tax basis instead of a pre-tax basis, but that hasn't gotten any push lately.
Yeah, that's a very fascinating question, because it really goes to the issue of parity and equality. If teams enjoy a state tax generated advantage, they can afford to pay a player less money than a team in a higher tax rate state. So shouldn't the leagues be actually trying to equalize that just for competitive reasons?
Well, the teams like the Miami Dolphins, the Dallas Cowboys, they flaunt that. When they go to free agency begins in March, they put that in their presentation to the players. Whereas teams like the Knicks and the Lakers, they have to overcome that. It's a big difference. And like I said, the basketball got a little push from players you wanted to do this on an after-tax basis, but the Players Association never got it pushed through. But I would think if one comes through, the other associations would come through as well.
Well, who would oppose on the league side? Who would oppose an equalization? We hear time and time again from all the different league offices how important the draft is, tanking, there's a salary cap. All of these rules are put in place to create competitive balance. Yet we have this disparity in free agency caused by the differences in state tax rates that basically give teams a competitive advantage over one another. What argument or what rationale could the league offices have in not providing some kind of an adjustment to each team's salary cap to take into account state tax rate differences? I mean, it may not be a simple formula, but but there has to be, I would think, some rational basis in which to adjust team salary caps just to put everybody on a level playing field. I mean, the Marlins, to begin with, will never be on a level playing field because they're a small market team that can't compete for the big fish. But Dallas, I mean, come on. I mean, that's just one more, one more arrow in, Jerry Jones's, stash to recruit players in a way that can give him an upper hand over all of the other teams in the NFL. So what's the argument for not doing that?
It's a good question, Danny. I'm not sure of the answer to that, but I know, like I said, I know for sure because I was approached by one team president in the NBA about doing that. And he said it got a little bit pushed, but not enough. So It maybe eventually would come through, and you're talking about, Garrett Cole and mm-hmm. Zach Wheeler and Steven Strasburg. You're talking about, big numbers, hundreds of million dollars. Each one of those guys is going to get more than $100 million. It's a lot of money if you take into account the tax jurisdiction. Well, Washington is very interesting because the state of Washington, D.C., doesn't tax non-residents. They only tax residents. So as the Devils go play there, twice a year, their players don't pay the tax. They don't have to. So Strasburg and Scherzer, if they're not residents of Washington, they're not paying tax. It's a high number. It's 8.95%.
Hold on a second. You're saying if Max Scherzer or Steven Strasburg were to reside in Maryland or Virginia, they wouldn't be taxed at all by the District of Columbia?
That's right.
What if they are residents of the District of Columbia? Then what's the tax rate?
8.95%.
Percent or dollars?
Yes, percent.
Okay. Why on earth would any professional athlete live in the District of Columbia when which neighboring states have no tax rates? What about Virginia and Maryland?
Virginia and Maryland have tax rates. Maryland is high. Maryland has two taxes. One is a state income tax and the other is local tax. The local tax is higher if you're a resident than a non-resident.
But 8.9% or 8.95% sounds like it would be higher than probably what
Maryland could be higher. But what if one of them lives in Florida? Then they really make out, right?
Yeah. They could take a private jet, to play at Nats Park, right? They could buy their own jet with the tax savings. Let's look at Garrett Cole. There's a lot of speculation that Garrett Cole will want to go home and play in California. The Yankees are pursuing him heavily. Can you tell me from a tax perspective, assuming that we're talking about the same contract value, what the difference would be in terms of tax savings were he to go to New York or live in New Jersey and play in New York as opposed to, living in Anaheim?
Okay, where do you want to presume that he was a resident of?
Give me the best case.
All right, why don't we just assume that he's a resident of where he plays?
Okay.
Yeah. So if he played in New York has a state income tax, 8.82%. And if he resided in one of the boroughs, in the city limits, he'd pay another close to 4% in tax. As opposed to California, it's a flat, not a flat fee, graduated fee of 13.3%. So California would be higher than New York, especially if he lived, in the Jersey confines or outside of the New York City, and you wouldn't have to pay that. California is significantly higher then. If he had to pay the city tax in New York, California is marginally higher.
All right. I mean, every year we go through the same, articles, your tax maps. I mean, every time there's free agency in the NFL or Major League Baseball, Robert Raiola becomes a TV person and you come on to talk about, state taxes in the context of free agency. But, truly, how many players anecdotally have based their playing decisions on which state has a lower tax rate? Are any of them doing that?
Some of them are. Some of them will come out and say, look, I did it because of the taxes. Some of them will go for the most money. And I always say, it's like I said before, it's not the gross, it's the net that makes really what you take home. I think it should be on your checklist. If you have 10 items when you're a free agent, this should be one of the 10 to check the box on state income taxes.
Okay,
I can tell you for sure, Boros is making his players make aware of this difference in state taxes.
Did Robinson Cano make a wise decision 6 years ago to spurn the New York Yankees and play for the Seattle Mariners? How did that benefit him from a tax perspective?
He plays for Seattle. Seattle plays in the division that's the best for in baseball because you got Houston there and you got the Texas Rangers there. So it's the best division to play for from a tax perspective. From a tax perspective, we figured out it was about 68% of his income, counting, you know, the portion earned in Houston, in Washington, and then the portion he earned in the other non-taxable state. So 68% of his income he paid no state tax on. So there's no doubt about it that, assuming he was a Washington resident.
Wow. Which of the athletes in this year's class of free agents do you think will make a decision? I mean, I guess it's hard to speculate what's in players' minds, but could you see any of the major free agents like Strasburg or Cole just coming down to hard numbers, which is going to be the best deal for him? Because leaving that kind of money on the table and losing it to state taxes, are they playing teams off one another to maybe improve offers to take into account the fact that they play in a city that has a higher state tax rate? Does that kind of negotiating occur?
I think it does. And I think you always, from a negotiating standpoint, you always want to keep the Yankees interested because the Yankees have a deep pocketbook. So maybe not from a tax perspective, but they'll, if you can keep it publicly believed, that will drive up the other teams' offers. It'd be interesting to see where the Astros come out of this, because the Astros are one power team that has no state tax, and who knows if they would be in the bidding on either of these players.
Well, they may also have no draft choices, depending upon how the Major League Baseball investigation goes. They may need to sign some free agents just to kind of stock their talent pool based upon the allegations of cheating.
That's a topic for another conduct detrimental of a podcast.
No shortage of topics, Robert. I've been on the bench for 2 years not doing any of these programs, and it just absolutely kills me every time there's a new scandal. Could be the cheating scandal or Antonio Brown's lawsuit. There's always something. If you look at the headlines, you know, from ESPN, invariably one or two of them have a legal component to them. So that one will certainly come around soon enough. Before we let you go, I do have to ask you some questions about your profile on Twitter and how you've managed as a certified public accountant, those types of professionals generally don't travel in the high-powered sports circles. How did you get into the industry?
Basically, back in 1990, late 80s, I was at Deloitte and Touche, and I joined forces with a gentleman, and we left and began our own practice. And we had done a lot of work in the area. And then I've been now at O'Connor Davies, and we have a great team of individuals working with me to help support, you know, doing the tax returns and helping with the backup, you know, for the tax map and the data that goes into that. So it's been a long time, but I come to work every day and I love what I do. And O'Connor Davies is tremendously supportive of what I do, and glad to be working in the industry.
Well, I got to ask you one other question related to your public profile. How on earth does a certified public accountant, and I don't mean to target CPAs. I mean, it's hard enough for lawyers to get a lot of traction publicly. How do you have so many Twitter followers? You have more Twitter followers than many professional athletes.
I just started to, you know, have a platform to put my information. And, you know, Darren Revelle taught me a lot about Twitter. And he helped by retweeting a lot of my tweets, and same thing with Adam Schefter. And when those people do it, you get more followers. I enjoy it a lot, and I've also gotten some business from it, especially from parents of college eligible NFL players that were in college, college professionals, college athletes, who ultimately became professionals and needed an accountant, and they reached out to me because of my Twitter profile.
You've really created a just sort of a persona for yourself. Congratulations on really an amazing and interesting career in the world of sports. And I want to thank you for shedding some light on these interesting controversies and subjects. I mean, the Jock tax will kind of have a life for a little while longer. So I can't thank you enough for being my debut guest on the rebooted version of Conduct Detrimental.
Thank you so much. Glad Conduct Detrimental is back. Listeners will get a lot out of it. And thank you for having me. My pleasure.
Great to talk to you, Robert. Be well, and I'll be in touch with you soon.
You got it. Thanks, Danny.
That wraps up another episode of Conduct Detrimental, the sports law podcast. If you enjoyed this episode and like the content that we're providing, please, if you don't mind, give us a good review on iTunes, Stitcher, Spotify, Facebook, Twitter, Google Play, SoundCloud, or any of the other platforms. in which you receive the best in class podcasting content. I would personally appreciate it. It helps us build the audience, and we will be back soon with another episode of Conduct Detrimental. Until next time, case dismissed and the jury is excused. Have a great day, everybody. Bye-bye. This podcast is sponsored by Wallach Legal, LLC, the country's first sports betting-focused law firm, representing clients all across this great land in matters relating to gaming law, sports wagering law, sports law, and yes, even litigation, including appellate litigation. If you have any questions about the show or suggestions for future topics or guests, or if you just want to be a guest yourself, or you're looking to hire a lawyer, you can reach me in either of two ways. First, follow me on Twitter. My Twitter handle is @WallachLegal. That's @WallachLegal. That's all uppercase, although I don't think it makes a difference. Or you can send me an email at the following email address, WallachLegal@gmail.com. That's WallachLegal@gmail.com. Thank you.